friends, welcome to my channel. In this lecture, we are going to learn on informal guidelines and normal forms, one normal form, second normal form, third normal form for the relation schemas. Let us see the outline. So we are going to learn on what are the different informal design guidelines for relation schemas, functional dependencies, normal form based on the primary keys, second and third normal forms. Let us first focus on the informal design guidelines for relation schema. As you know that we have four informal guidelines which may be used to measure the determine the quality of relation schema design. Those are making sure that the semantics of the attributes is clear in the schema, reducing the redundant information in tuples, reducing the null values in the tuples, and disallowing the possibility of generating spurious tuples. So first let us see what are these guidelines here, right? And based on this, how we can improvise the designing of the relation schema. First we'll see how can we make sure that the semantics of the attributes is clear in the schema. Actually, semantics specifies how to interpret the attribute values stored in a tuple of the relation and how these attribute values in a tuple relate to each other. So for example, you have a relation called employee and we have attributes as employee ID, employee name, employee age, employee address. Along with that, if you also have some other attribute like department number, department name and department location. Now the question is how these all the attributes in a single relation employees are related to each other, right? So let us see this schema here. As we can see clearly, there is a five entities here. So employee is a relation wherein it has employee name, SSN being the key attribute, birth date, address and department number. So in this case, department number is acting as a foreign key as it is a primary key attribute in the department table, and department MG or SSN is a foreign key as it is linking the SSN of the employee table. We have department location, department number and department location. So it is a multi-valued attribute as some department will have multiple locations. We have project table where we have project number as a primary key and department number is a foreign key in that particular relation. And we have works on table. So it indicates which employee works on M number of employee works on N number of projects, and how many hours he have worked on each project, right? So as you can see, this entire table is a good design. Why? Because we can see that not all the attributes are in a single relation. So we can see that all each and every attribute in the employee table are implying the primary key attributes. So all these non-prime attributes are implies the prime attribute in the single relation. Similarly, here department name is relied on department number, right? So when we design a particular relation, we should make sure that every attribute is related to the prime attribute of that particular relation. So let us see what is the guideline one here. Design a relation schema so that it is easy to explain its meaning. As we have seen earlier, that was a design made to make sure that every single attributes are interrelated to each other and it explains the meaning of a relation. Do not combine attributes from multiple entity types and relation types into a single relation. So what happens if you try to combine attributes from multiple entities? You will end up with a poor design here. So that will give rise to different types of anomalies like insertion anomaly, deletion anomaly and update anomalies. So we are going to learn all these things in depth in my next slides. So we can see that in a given relation, there is nothing wrong logically, but we call this relation as a poor design. Why? Because it violates guideline one. As in, already we have mentioned that in guideline one, make sure all the attributes has a meaning in the particular relation and we should not combine multiple attributes from the different entity types. As you can see here, this is a table employee department. We have employee name, SSN, birth date, address, D number, D name and department manager SSN. Here department number, department name and department manager SSN do not rely on the same particular table, right? If it is, if this particular attributes are stored in a single relation, it will end up with the redundant tuples, and also sometimes it will give rise to the anomalies. So in such case, what we do, we just try to divide, decompose this particular relation into two relation. As SSN is a prime attribute here, it implies employee name, birth date, address and department number, and department number should be stored in the different table called as department, which implies department name and department manager SSN. We have employee project here, SSN, project number, HARS, employee name, project name and project location. So this particular relation is also a poor design, as it includes multiple attributes from the multiple entity types. So here we can divide this or decompose this relation into three relation, as SSN employee number, SSN and project number will give you HARS, SSN alone will give you employee name, project number will give you project name and project location. If you try to decompose a single universal relation into the multiple relations, then definitely it will get rid of all kind of redundancies, all kind of null values and also the anomalies in a relation, right? So this is guideline one. Let us see what are the other problems we are going to face with respect to the poor design of a schema. Redundant information in tuples and update anomalies. So what is the goal of schema design? It is to minimize the storage space used by the base relation. So we can classify this into insertion anomalies, deletion anomalies and update anomalies, or we call, can also call it as a modification anomalies. You can see in the table here, in employee department table, you have department name and department manager SSN as the extra attribute, and if this is there in a single relation, then this will lead to a redundant values, and our main object is to get rid of all the redundant values. And also you can see it in another relation, the particular SSN project number HARS and ename here. So HARS, ename, project name and project location will lead to a redundant tuples in a relation. So how do we get rid of all these things? So let us see first what are the different types of anomalies, and later we'll decide how to get rid of all these anomalies. So what is insertion anomalies here? It occurs when certain attributes cannot be inserted in database without the presence of other attribute. Now for example, if the students would like to enroll for a department, that means department should be available. If the department itself is not available, then we cannot add any, or not, we cannot enroll any student for the department. Let us see one example here. We have student number, course number, student name, address and course. So this is a schema design over here. Now let us see what happens with respect to the insertion anomaly in this case. Here we cannot add a new course unless we have at least one student enrolled on the course. So for example, if you would like to add a new course number like 9000, then we can, if there are no students enrolled for that particular course, then all the rest of the attributes will be either will be filled with the null values. So this will lead to the insertion anomalies. So our main object is to avoid redundant values, also to avoid the null values in the attributes. So in this case, it is clearly displaying us that we cannot add a new course unless any one student enrolled for that particular course. Similarly, when we talk about deletion anomaly, so for example, if we want to delete a particular student from the particular student in a given relation, so what happens if I delete one student, the course number and all other information also will get deleted. That means assume that only one student enrolled for the particular course, right? And if you delete that particular student from the relation, then the course also will get deleted, which we don't want it to happen. But due to the poor design, that particular attribute also will get deleted. So we need to take a lot of care in this regard, right? And assume that we have now around 5 tuples and S30 being the final tuple in this. So what happens if the student S30 is the last student to leave the course? So what will happen? All the information about the courses are also been lost. So this will lead to the deletion anomaly. Why this has happened? Because of the poor schema design. One more anomaly is there, that we call it as a modification anomaly or update anomaly. As you can clearly see that the student Jones, right, is been enrolled for more than one course. As you can see, 9201 and 9267, right? The course number are different here, but now I would like to change his address. So in this case, what we can do, how many number of course he has enrolled for? Two courses, and two times I need to change his address instead of once. So now in this case, it is very simple. We need to just change only the two tuples. But what if there are 100 tuples which have been redundantly appeared in the particular relay? Then 100 times we need to change that particular address. So this will lead to the update anomalies also. Even this has happened because of the poor database design. Right? So based on these preceding three anomalies, we can state the guideline 2. It says that design the base relation schema so that no insertion, deletion or modification anomalies are present in the relations. If any anomalies are present, note them clearly and make sure that the programs that update the database will operate correctly. Right? Now let us see about the null values in the tuples. What happens if there are more number of null values in the attribute? The question arises here is, if there are more number of nulls in a particular attribute, whether that attribute will be of much use for us. Right? So in some schema designs, we may group many attributes together into a fat relation. Here fat relation in the sense, there are more number of attributes in a single relation, wherein not all the attributes are totally functionally dependent on the prime attribute. If many of the attributes do not apply to all the tuples in a relation, we end up with many nulls in those tuples. Right? So if I want to say that a particular student is having multiple phone numbers, many phone numbers. So if I say that phone number 1, phone number 2 and phone number 3, only few students will have more than 2 phone numbers. Not all the students will have. So rest of the people will keep that particular attribute as a blank value. So it will be null values in this case. So we should try to avoid it. And also we can consider a department having multiple locations. Not all the department will have more than two locations. Some department will have more than two locations. So if you have three attributes like department location 1, department location 2 and department location 3, apart from one or two tuples, rest all the tuples will be filled with the null values. So we should try to avoid such kind of null values in the tuples. Right? The situation may arise that attribute does not apply to this tuple. There are few attributes does not apply to the particular tuple. In the case that for example, if I ask your apartment number, if you are staying it in your own house, then you may not have a apartment number. So if you are not staying in apartment, so that particular attribute will not be applicable to you. Attribute value for this tuple is unknown. Few attributes will be asked that you do not know the data of it. So definitely we'll put a null value in this case. The value is known but absent. Few people are there, they know the particular data but they do not want to share, especially the phone numbers. So in such cases what happens? More number of null values will be getting inserted into the tuples. So we need to take care in a guideline 3 as far as possible, avoid placing attributes in a base relation whose value may frequently be null. If nulls are unavoidable, make sure that they apply in the exceptional cases only and do not apply to a majority of tuples in the relation. Generation of spurious tuple. This is one of the most interesting case here. Especially this will get generated whenever you try to attempt a natural join. Now what is spurious here? Spurious means generation of the extra tuples without our notice. So for example, you had a universal relation, relation R, which includes A, B, C, D, right? Assume that that particular relation is not normalized. So we need to decompose that relation into multiple relation. And finally, you would like to join that particular relation because you would like to fetch attributes from the multiple entity types. In such case, if we try to use natural join, please be very cautious here. Only the primary key and the foreign key of the particular attribute header can have the same name. Other than prime attribute, like a non-prime attribute, if it has the same name, then this will give rise to the spurious tuples, right? Let me show an example for you here. As you can see here, there are two entities here. One is employee location, another is employee project. So employee location has a two attribute, employee name and P location, right? Here employee name and P location together is considered as a primary key. And in employee project one, SSN, P number and HARS are considered as a primary key, right? SSN and P number is considered the primary key, and HARS, P name and P location are the non-prime attribute here. But you can clearly see that the P location here, which is a prime attribute, and P location here, which is a non-prime attribute, is given with the same attribute header. But if you're not using natural join, then no problem. But if you're using a natural join, then what it will do, that database will naturally joins the primary key of employee location to the non-primary key or non-prime attribute of employee project one relation. So due to this, what will happen? Automatically you will end up with the spurious tuple, means extra tuples will get generated without our notice, and that should not happen. Right? And you can see that this is the table what we had earlier, and due to the particular natural join, you ended up with the spurious tuples here. So lot of datas are getting generated without our notice. So this happens because of a natural join, right? So problem is, if a natural join is performed on the above two relation, it produces more tuples than the original set of tuples in employee project. These additional tuples that were not in employee project are called as spurious tuple, because they represent spurious or wrong information. Spurious means wrong information, which are not valid. That means if you're trying to apply the natural join for the given relation, make sure that the primary key and the foreign key are only given as the same attribute header, or else you can use a theta join wherein you only specify the equality condition among the relations. Hope you understand. So in this case, we need to follow the guideline 4. It clearly says that design relation schema so that they can be joined with equality condition on attribute that are either primary keys or foreign keys in a way that guarantees that no spurious tuples are generated. So avoid relation that contain matching attribute that are not foreign key and primary key combination, because joining on such attributes may produce you the spurious tuple, as we had already seen just now. So let us summarize the discussion what we had. So the problems what we have pointed out so far is anomalies. Three types of anomalies we have learned: insertion, deletion and update anomalies. So this will cause the redundant work to be done during we try to insert a new record, or we are going to delete an existing record, or we would like to modify a existing record in a relation. And wastage of storage space due to nulls, lot of nulls. If you can't avoid nulls, make sure it is not frequently been used in the tuples, and try to avoid as much as redundant values in the tuples. And when you are trying to join the relation, make sure the primary key and foreign key are only with given with the same attribute header names, or else it will end up with the spurious tuples. Now let us see what is a functional dependencies in a given relation. A functional dependency is denoted by x implies y, where y is a subset of x. Here x is a prime attribute and y is a non-prime attribute, right? And it's a property of the semantics. Here semantics means the meaning of the attribute. The database designers will use their understanding of the semantics of attributes of R to specify the functional dependency in a relation. As you can see clearly in the example, SSN is a prime attribute which will imply the employee name. P number, that is a project number, will give you the details of project name and project location. As well as if you try to make these two primary keys a super key like SSN and P number together, and that will give you the hash here. So every single attribute in a relation are functionally dependent on the prime attribute here. And we should know the what are the different types of functional dependency. First one is a fully functional dependencies, where y is a subset of x, when we call it as a x implies y. So it says that if removal of any attribute a from x means that a dependency does not hold anyway. So for example, if I tell SSN and project number together gives you har, right? If I remove SSN from the relation now, then P number alone cannot give you hars. P number can give you project name, but it cannot give you hars, because it does not know which is a, who is the employee who was working on that particular project. Neither if I remove project number from that particular relation, SSN alone cannot give you hars, because SSN can give you employee name and other details, but without knowing the project number, I cannot give you the details of the har. So har is fully functionally dependent on the SSN and P number in this case. And the second type of functional dependency is a partial functional dependencies. Here, if removal of any attribute to A from X, and dependency still hold, right? For example, SSN and P number gives you employee name is partial here, because SSN alone can give you employee name, right? If you remove P number from this relation, and the relation will still hold, because SSN alone can also give you employee name. So this is a partial functional dependencies. The third type of functional dependency is the transitive dependencies. In this case, we need to check whether if x implies y and y implies z, then x implies z also hold. It's somewhat like SSN will give you department number, and department will give you department manager SSN, then SSN will also give you department manager SSN. And the last type of functional dependency, trivial functional dependency. Here, if x implies y holds, where y is a subset of x, then it is called as a trivial functional dependency. Non-trivial, if a functional dependency x implies y holds, where y is not a subset of x, then it is called as a non-trivial functional dependency. Now let us see the different normalization forms which you need to impose on a relation, because every relation has to be normalized to consider it to be a good design. So this process was first proposed by Codd in 1972. He has this proposed the three normalization form at the beginning, like first normalization form, second and third, along with the BCNF, that is Boyce Code normal form. And all these normal forms are based on the functional dependencies among the attribute of a relation. Later on, for multivalue dependencies and joint dependencies, he has also proposed 4NF and 5NF. So in this lecture, we'll focus only on first, second and third normal form. In my next lecture, you are going to learn on BCNF, 4NF and 5NF. So here, normalization means it's a filtering process, or we are going to analyze the given relation schema based on their functional dependencies and primary keys to achieve the desirable properties. So far in the informal design guidelines, we have seen that whenever relation schemas are not designed properly, you may end up with the spurious tuples or redundant values or null values. Now our job is to normalize each and every relation so that we can get rid of redundancies, anomalies and null values in the tuples. So we call normalization as a filtering or purification process to make the designs have successfully better quality. So we consider a super key of a relation R is a set of attribute S, subset of R, with the property that no two tuples t1 and t2 in any legal relation state of R will have t1 of s equal to t2 of s. Right? A key is a super key with the additional property that removal of any attribute from K will cause K not to be a super key anymore. You had seen that SSN and project number will together give you HARS. So SSN and project, now SSN was actually a primary key, project number is also a primary key in another table. So if you consider both together as a super key, that will give you another attribute. That particular attribute is totally and fully functionally dependent on the prime attribute, that is super key. So if there is any, if you remove any one attribute from the super key and still it be able to identify the another attribute, then it is not called as a super key, right? So please keep this information in your mind. An attribute of relation schema is called a prime attribute of R if it is a member of some candidate key of R. An attribute is called non-prime if it is a non-prime attribute, that is if it is not a member of any candidate key. So SSN and P number are prime attribute of Voxon, whereas some other attributes of Voxon are non-prime attribute. Like for example, SSN and P number in Voxon table will be like a prime attribute and the HARS will be the non-prime attribute. Let us see what is first normalization form says. It states that a domain of an attribute must include only atomic values. That means you can see the table here. In this table, the department location is violating 1NF because it holds more than one value. So one first normalization norm clearly says that every single attribute in a relation should hold at least only one value, that is atomic value. That means that particular value should not be divisible further, right? So how to overcome this particular thing? Either you can divide the table or you can divide the attributes here, like department name, department number, department manager, SSN and department location you have already. So you can just divide the number of attributes like department location 1, location 2 and location 3. So if you do so, what will happen? As I already told you, not all the department will have the multiple location. When particular department doesn't have a multiple location, then most of the time the department location 2 and 3 will be kept as null. And we already learned in the informal design guidelines saying that we should avoid the null values, right? So either we can do it in this way, we divide the table like department name, department number, department manager, SSN, department number and department location. Either we can divide the particular table or we can also expand the number of attributes in a relation, but both has a disadvantage. If you keep on dividing the number of table, so definitely the storage space may get decreased, and if you try to divide the number of attributes into more number of attributes in a given relation, then it will give rise to the null values in a tuples. So 1NF means we should get rid of multiple or multi-valued attribute in a single attribute. Let us see what is second normal form. This clearly states that every relation should get rid of partial dependencies. So the definition is a relation schema R is in 2NF if every non-prime attribute A in R is fully functionally dependent on the primary key of R. Right? So for example, if I want to take student ID, course ID will give you course name. So actually course ID will give you course name, but student ID will not give you any course name. In such case, we need to remove that student ID from that relation and we have to preserve that attribute in another relation. So when you do such things, we call that normalization form as a second normalization form, right? So you can see here, in the example 1, SSN P number gives R is fully functionality because neither SSN will give you HARS nor project number will give you HARS hold. So this is in 2NF. But when you see about a partial dip, SSN P number gives E name. So here SSN will give you E name, but project number will not give you E name. So in this case, we need to shift this project number to some other relation. So this is violating 2NF. We need to consider into a proper design. So here you can clearly see that in a given relation, SSN project number, HARS employee name, project name and project location. We can decompose this relation into three functional dependency relation, as we know that SSN and project number will give you HARS, SSN will only give you employee name, and project number will give you project name and project location. So employee project is divided into employee project 1, project 2 and project 3. So this was violating the second normalization form, because it is having all the partial dependencies in a single relation. Now we have made it into three different relations. So this is in a second normal form. In the third normal form, it should be in 2NF and it should get rid of transitive dependencies. Transitive dependency, as I already mentioned, if X implies Y and Y implies Z, then X implies Z condition should not be there in the single relation. If it is there, then this will give rise to the redundant values, right? So we need to remove all the transitive dependencies in a relation. So it defines that a relation schema R is in 3NF if it is satisfied 2NF and no non-prime attribute of R is transitively dependent on the primary key. You see in the relation here, employee name, SSN, birth date, address, D number, D manager, SSN. SSN will give you employee name, birth date, address and D number, but D number will give you department name and department manager, SSN. In this case, so employee SSN will give you D number and D number will give you D manager SSN. That means SSN will also give you D manager SSN, right? So this particular transitive dependency should not be available in a single relation, because it will give rise to the lot of redundant tuples in a relation. In this case, what we do, we decompose the relation into the multiple relation, as we store SSN employee name, birth date, address and D number in a single relation, and D number, department name and department manager SSN in the second relation. And we made sure that the two relation, when we join it, we will get back the same output as we got earlier without even having any spurious tuples here, because here D number is the primary key in department table and D number is a foreign key in a employee table. So these are the two common attributes. If we try to join this, we will be able to access all the attributes from the two relation. So this satisfies the third normal form. So in my next lecture, we are going to learn on Boyce code normal form, which is stricter than third normal form, along with the how to get rid of multi-value dependencies via 4NF and get rid of joint dependencies by use of 5 normalization form or 5th normalization form. Hope you all understand this. Thank you for watching. Happy learning. Please do subscribe my channel for more facts on DBMS. Thank you very much.